Thanks.
A little cold for him this morning, perhaps, but our scripture up here for meditation this morning is from Psalm 139, and this is because we're still celebrating, remembering Sanctity of Human Life Sunday, or Sanctity of Human Life Month, January is. So I trust you spend a little time to read and think about these meditations on Sunday morning. Anyways, let's begin with a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we want to give you the glory for all things. Thank you for another day of life. And we accept this today, Father, as a gift. We accept it as a stewardship to live this day for your honor and glory. Father, we also accept this day as a special day, the Lord's Day. Your people have come together to meet, to worship, to fellowship as the people of God, to study your holy word, to learn from it, and to encourage one another in the things of the Lord, to receive instruction. Father, we've come to honor you. We've carved out a portion of our day, a portion of our week, to devote to you, because we love you and we love your people, and we want to honor you. And so we just ask the Lord, as you meet with us today, that your Holy Spirit would minister to us, convict us where we need convicting, encourage us where we need encouraging. Lord, just to bolster us up, help us to be more profitable servants for you, and we'll give you the praise in Jesus' name. Amen. We'll start off with some announcements here. Wednesday night is our midweek prayer and praise service, 7 o'clock Wednesday nights. Just an update from the CDC. I'd like to keep everybody informed. You have two options now. One, you can catch Omicron and experience mild cold or flu-like symptoms. Or two, your other option is get 3 or 4 jabs, wear 2 masks, social distance, isolate, and catch Omicron and experience mild cold flu symptoms. Okay? Just wanted you to be aware of both your options. All right, Oakley's up next Sunday for our snow cleaning, if we have any. And serving the Lord cleaning church this week is Justin, Nancy, and Christina. And those on the left there, Nancy, Justin, Christina, Candy, Deb, Pastor, Thals, Bertners, Wesleys, Ganyos, Gefels, and Venables are those who are on the regular church cleaning schedule. So if you have an opportunity, thank them for how clean the church is each week. Next Sunday, very important service. We observe the Lord's Supper monthly. And those 12 months of the year, I believe those services are the most important services for any child of God, to come together and observe the Lord's Supper. So we encourage you to do that. That'll be during our 11 o'clock service next Sunday morning. All right. Are there any other announcements? We have a number of people still sick with COVID or colds and flus and sore throats. And so we still are missing a lot of our folk, but we're thankful you're here. So let's take our hymn books and turn to number 498, When We All Get to Heaven. And we'll stand and sing all 4 verses. song's not true. Well, in a sense, because not everybody's going to get to heaven. Now, I hope that we all sang that as when we all get to heaven. But I think I've been to, I don't know, hundreds of funerals. I've personally done over 200 funerals in my ministry, but I've been to many, many more, and I don't think I've ever been to one single funeral where they didn't say, well, they're in a better place now. And that's not always the truth, though. There is a heaven and there is a hell. There is an afterlife, an eternal afterlife. And it's only for those who have been saved through the blood of Jesus Christ that are going to be we all that get to heaven. So I hope you're part of that. All right. As I mentioned, this is Sanctity of Human Life Month. And even though I have not had one specific Sunday dedicated or message to it, I've had a few little briefings. And I think the matter is extremely important, particularly because our culture doesn't hold to this position anymore. But it's very important that we understand what God's Word says, what His view of life is, because that's what we want our view of life to be. We looked at these last week, that man is sacred. He's made in the image of God. That is, male and female created He them in His image, okay? We are both created in His image. All human life is. As God's image bearer, man is God's vice regent on the earth. He's not part of the animal kingdom. He is above all the animal kingdom. He named the animals. God set him to have dominion over all the fish of the sea, fowl of the air, over all the things that creep on this earth. Man is above that. He's created in the image of God and has dominion. God's image bearers do not reproduce, but that rather they procreate. It's a difference between the animal realm and human beings. We bring into existence, a mother and a father together bring into existence an immortal soul, a human being, immortal being. And fourth, to kill, maim, or curse God's image bearer is actually an assault on God Himself. Scriptures are pretty clear. So, man being this sacred image, there's a lot of consequences, teachings concerning that. Having God's view of Scripture means that we are opposed, that we, God's view is opposed to abortion, the killing of an infant in the womb. We're opposed to birth control methods that kill after conception. Opposed to fetal stem cell research or any such research that encourages and uses aborted fetal tissue. And that includes some vaccines that use the fetal tissue. We're opposed to racism. There is only one human race. And so to be prejudiced or biased against some other ethnic culture or skin color or hair color or eye color or ear size or language is utter foolishness. We're opposed to sexism or sex discrimination, as though male or female or one or the other are not created in the image of God. They both are. We're opposed to euthanasia. We believe that it is the right of life. All people have the right to life, elderly, sick, infirmed, whatever. We're opposed to the cursing, ridicule, abuse, or defrauding of fellow human beings. James chapter 3 clearly says this. He says that out of the same mouth, we bless God, and yet we curse fellow man. He says these things ought not to be so. Mankind is made in the image of God. He's in God's similitude, likeness. And so to curse fellow man would be the same thing as cursing God. And so we do not do that. We're opposed to slavery, the denial of human rights to any and all people. We're opposed to anything that does harm to one's physical body, hastens its demise, destroys its health, or in any foolish way increases the likelihood of sickness or death. God has given us our bodies. He's given us life, and it's a stewardship we're responsible to care for and to maintain life as best we can. We know we're living in a world in which we all get sick and die eventually, but we don't want to personally do anything to hasten that. We're also opposed to any withholding of compassion and care for handicapped or disabled people. And all this really comes from that one biblical teaching, of the sanctity of all human life. So there's a lot of things that go along with this. There are hundreds of thousands, millions of people, Christians, who do not get involved in church ministries, or who do not proceed in honoring the Lord in various ministries, because they say, "No, I was a sinner in my past. I have a very sinful past, and therefore I cannot serve the Lord." And some people, particularly that bottom one, you notice they're abortion. There are people who said, "Well, I contributed. I encouraged my fiance to have an abortion, or I had an abortion, and therefore I'm disqualified, and I can never serve the Lord. I can never be involved in Christian ministries." And that is not true. There are some pastors, by the way, who will not preach on sin because they don't want to lay a guilt trip on anybody. But that's foolishness, too. To restrain from preaching about sin is really to undermine the whole gospel. And when we talk about the gospel of Jesus Christ, the word gospel is a word which, it's a Greek word which means good news, the good news of Jesus Christ. Well, what is the good news? Well, the good news really is the whole Bible is good news. It starts right from Genesis 1, that we had a holy God who created a good world. He created everything, and he said it's good. He created mankind in his image, sinless, untried righteousness, created them to worship him and to have fellowship with him forever. And yet these image bearers, mankind, Adam and Eve, willfully, intentionally sinned, violated, transgressed, disobeyed their creator. They rebelled against God. And in so doing, they broke fellowship with God and put themselves in a condition of sinfulness of which all of us have been born into. And Adam and Eve, right from the get-go, when they sinned, they were worthy of eternal condemnation. They were worthy of the wrath of God. But God, in his goodness and grace, temporarily withheld judgment. He withheld his wrath on mankind. And he did it for a few thousand years until, in the fullness of time, God sent forth his Son, Galatians 4:4 says, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem, that is to rescue, to save. And so Christ then went to the cross of Calvary. That's the whole purpose. Christ came, Jesus came to this earth, was so that living a perfect, sinless human life, he could then be our substitute, the substitute for sinners. And Jesus went to the cross of Calvary, and there at the cross, he stood in our place as a sinner. He stood in our place. Not, he wasn't a sinner, we were. And our sins on him were laid. And he experienced the wrath of God, the penalty for my sin, the punishment, the eternal wrath of God for my sin and your sin. He bore, he paid the penalty for our sin. And 3 days later, God the Father confirmed the efficacy of the Son's sacrifice, his substitute sacrifice for sinners, by raising him from the dead, then ascended into heaven and seated him at his right hand. That's the good news. The good news is that those who believe in the Lord Jesus Christ can have the forgiveness of sins. We can't undo a sinful past, but our sinful past can be forgiven. And it's through Jesus Christ. It's a gift. It's not of works. Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 and 9 are pretty clear that it's not by works that we have done, but by his grace. Through faith he saved us. And because it's his gift, no one can boast. No one can say, "Well, I was better than them. I was smarter than them. I was more righteous than somebody else." That has nothing to do with it. We are all sinners, worthy of the wrath of God. But Christ paid the debt, and by faith in him, we have been saved. And when God saves a person, God declares them just. Romans chapters 3 and 4 talk a lot about this, but here we have sinful people. And yet God the Father sends his Son to pay their penalty. And now God the Father can declare his elect people, his chosen people. He makes this declaration that they are just. That's the word justification. He declares them righteous. How can you declare a sinner righteous? Well, he can do that because their sin was paid for by Christ and forgiven. And therefore God is able to declare them righteous. And that's the truth. So the starting point for healing is found in the gospel. So it's not a matter of not preaching about sin. It's about the importance of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And so all sinners, doesn't matter how bad of a sinner you are, what kind of a sinner, how long you've been living a sinful past, any sinner can find forgiveness, cleansing, freedom, fullness in Christ Jesus. Sadly, however, there are pastors who will not preach the whole counsel of God. There are certain passages of Scripture that they skip over, because, well, that might not go over so well. It's a kind of a touchy subject. Let's not preach on that. That's a little too sensitive. Oh, that's politically incorrect. I don't think people are good. That's too controversial. And so they say, well, we're not going to preach on those subjects. But you know what? When a pastor refuses to preach on sin, he is undermining the very gospel that he's ordained to preach. He's not sparing people guilt. He's sparing them healing and forgiveness. Because until a person is brought, confronted with the truth of their sin, they will not seek forgiveness in Christ. Until a person, you know, in fact, sometimes people get mad and get upset when the pastor preaches about different sins. I don't care what they are, but you're laying guilt on us. No, what a pastor is doing when they're preaching the truth of Christ, and inevitably there will always be guilt because none of us can ever measure up. But when there's that guilt and the conviction of sin, it's to point people to Christ, forgiveness and cleansing. That's restoration. That's recovery. That's renewal. That's healing. Wounded souls need to be healed. And so for a pastor to ignore the preaching of that is foolishness. In fact, we're told to preach the word, to preach the whole counsel of God. It says in 2 Timothy, be ready in season and out of season. That is, when it's convenient or when it's not convenient. Whether people like to hear it or whether they don't like to hear it. Preach the word. The whole word, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. Do it with convince, rebuke, exhort with all long suffering and teaching. John says this. He says, if we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves. And the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, to confess means to acknowledge. It's to be confronted with the truth and say, yes to God. Yes, right. I am a sinner. I failed. I've fallen short. Your word says it's wrong and I did it. I'm a sinner. That's confessing our sins. And when we do that, He, God, is faithful. And He's just to forgive us our sins. How can we be just? Because Christ paid the debt. And He's just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Proverbs tells us that he who covers his sins, to ignore it, to try to hide it, to cover it, will not prosper. But whoever confesses and forsakes them, will have mercy. So when a pastor preaches and you start feeling guilty, be thankful. That's the kindest thing a pastor can do, is lead people to confront their sinfulness and to confess it, to acknowledge it before God, and to find forgiveness and cleansing. So when we preach about the matters of abortion, for example, or homosexuality, or adultery, or lying, or stealing, or any of the other sins that God enumerates in Scripture, you're not here, it's not to make you feel guilty and to go away from here guilty. Nobody should. Because we preach Christ also. The solution. The cure. The healing. I remember when, 2 years ago, a couple months, when Deb was diagnosed with stage 4 cancer. And we had that meeting with the oncologist, our first meeting. It was a very uncomfortable meeting. And he spent a great deal of time talking about the cancer. and what it was and what kind it was and where it spread. But he didn't stop there just talking about the cancer. He also talked about a plan for healing. He had a treatment plan that we praise God he used to bring about complete healing in Deb's life for right now. So we praise the Lord for that. And that's the same as the pastor. Yes, we preach whatever God has in his word, we just preach it. And when we feel guilty, when we're confronted by the truth of God's word and we feel guilty, that's good. That's the Spirit's work. Because we have forgiveness through the grace of God, through the sacrifice of Jesus Christ. So I hope you don't ever go home feeling guilty. I hope you go home feeling cleansed and renewed and recovered every Sunday. That's the goal. But yes, we believe that abortion is sin. And people who've gone through or been a part of abortions say, I'm so guilty. No, find your cleansing in Jesus Christ. Like any sinner, there can be complete forgiveness. And you can go on with fullness of joy, guilt-free living, because you know that your sin, past, present, and future, has been paid for and forgiven by Jesus Christ. All right. Well, the truth is we're all sinners saved by grace. We're going to sing hymn number 474. 474, only a sinner saved by grace. And we'll stand again and we sing all four verses.
I'm
may be seated. And ushers, would you come and receive our Lord's tithes and offerings, please? Brother John, would you ask God's blessing on our offerings?
Father, we just want to thank you for bringing us here today. Thank you for giving us the life you have given us and putting us here and when you chose. We just pray that as we give forth what you have given us, that we would be cheerful and always giving, Lord, and just pray that as we leave here today, we do feel refreshed in knowing that our sins are forgiven in you. We love you and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.
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 Books once again, turn to number 513, He the Pearly Gates Will Open. 513. Stand as we sing, please. Come on. may be seated. Thank you. Thank you, instrumentalists, for the good playing. And we'll dismiss our children for Children's Church. Go with Aunt Deb. Well, we're talking about generosity and grace giving. We got here from our study in Proverbs chapter 11, verse 24. And there it talks about there is one who scatters, yet increases more. The more generous, you sow sparingly, you're going to reap sparingly. You sow bountifully, you're going to reap bountifully. And that's what that proverb teaches. And there's also one who withholds more than is right, but it leads to poverty. People who hoard, greedy people, stingy people, God sees to it that it leads to poverty. Poverty of soul, poverty of pocketbook, perhaps. Don't rob God in Malachi. Don't rob yourself of the blessings. Don't rob your church family, 2 Corinthians 8 and 9. So that's where we are. We're talking about grace giving. And we call it grace giving because the word grace is used more in these two chapters than any, well, in chapter 8, more than any chapter in the whole Bible. And it's all about giving. In fact, it's interesting, that's where it's used, but the word, even though those two chapters are all about giving money, an offering to God, Paul is talking about this giving of money. That's a difficult subject sometimes to talk about. It's a touchy subject, a sensitive subject with people. I've seen bumper stickers that say, if you love Jesus, tithe. Anybody can honk. But put your money where your mouth is. Put your wallet where your mouth is. If you love Jesus, give him your offerings. But it is a sensitive subject. And sometimes even as a pastor, that's one of those subjects some pastors don't even talk about because it's controversial, it's sensitive, and people aren't going to come back if they hear a pastor talk about finances. But again, the pastor's responsibility is to preach the word, preach the whole counsel of God. And I am so glad that God in his word has given us a lot of scriptures that deal just with this. Two whole chapters here by the Apostle Paul that deal specifically with giving. Now, something that's interesting, too, though, that even though he's talking about giving money, taking up offerings, 1 Corinthians 16, he says, every Sunday, lay by him inside, as God has prospered, because I'm going to come and I'm going to pick up this money to take to the church at Jerusalem, but he says, I don't want to have any gatherings when I come. I want you every week. I want you to be laying money aside. And he's talking about that. And then 2 Corinthians 8 and 9, he's talking about the same thing. But you know what? He never uses the word money. Isn't that interesting? Because when we give, even though we may write a check or put cash in, or whatever, when we give our money to the Lord, it's not just giving money. It's not a financial transaction. It's all of a sudden becomes a sacred thing. It's a spiritual issue. And Paul, in these two chapters, he calls it a liberality. The people's liberality. Well, he's referring to their giving of their money. It was called a grace. Matter of fact, it's called a grace a number of times. The word grace is a gift. It's a gift. They didn't have to do it. They didn't earn anything by it. It was unconditional. It was a gift. He gave it. It was grace. It's a service. The word service means to serve, to minister to people. And it's called a ministration or a service to people. He calls it a communion. Communion, or literally fellowship. It's the Greek word koinonia. And he says that it's another phrase he gives for this offering, that they would receive this offering, this koinonia. It's their share. It's their participation. It's their part in the work of God. We want to have a part in this. And that's what it's called, a communion. It's called a munificence, literally a lavish gift. That's what it is. It's a gift again. It's a bountiful gift. It's called a blessing. He never refers to it as money. It's all these other things. And it's a manifestation of love. This is a token of your love. A manifestation of love. And so even though it is, the whole chapter is two chapters about giving their money, He never still calls it money. He calls it because it has a different character. In the Christian realm, when we're giving, it's we're giving to God and we're giving to His people, we're giving to His work, we're giving to His church, we're giving to His gospel ministry. And all of a sudden, what we say is money in the secular realm takes on something of a whole new character. And so pastors should not be embarrassed to talk about it, because it's not just money. We're not asking people to give money. We're asking to give grace and service and communion and service and munificence and blessings and manifestations of love. That's what they really are. It's a whole new character than the world has. Well, that's what we're going to talk about again. So if you turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 8, we're going to take up here. And I know we don't have much time. You said you spent too much time on the abortion issue. No, you can't spend too much time on that. Those are some of the fundamental principles of the Word of God. And the sanctity of human life is an extremely important issue. So I don't feel bad at all. What we don't cover today in 2 Corinthians 8, we'll get to next week or the week after or the week after. So until the Lord comes, we're just going to keep plugging away and preaching the Word. So hang in there. So the churches of... He's writing in chapter 8, verse 1, 2 Corinthians 8, 1, "Brethren, we make known to you the grace of God bestowed on the churches of Macedonia, that in a great trial of affliction, the abundance of their joy and their deep poverty abounded to the riches of their liberality." And so he's talking now, and what we'll, you can sort of follow along here, but down in this bottom corner here is Jerusalem, and that was the church. About AD 45, 46, there was a great famine. And it was actually around the whole Roman Empire was affected by it, but it was centered in Israel and Palestine. And so the churches up here, Antioch, they heard about it, chapter 11, and they decided to send gifts down to the church there also of money. But then Paul, and I'll sort of walk this around so you get an idea. Paul is on his second missionary journey, and he's coming over here, and he's going to visit the churches. Now, this is where the famine is right here. Okay? Stuart and James, little James, they're undergoing a terrible famine here. And so all the other churches of God, we're feeling really bad about this when we hear about the famine and the need here. And so Paul's going to go up, and Stephen here, the church at Antioch, these brethren here, they get together and say, we got to help those folks. And so they took up an offering. It says it pleased them. It seemed good to them to send an offering. And so they did. And Paul goes on his missionary journeys, and he comes back here, and he's going through Dalton here, church at Iconium, Deb, Lystra, Derby, Iconium, Lystra. He goes to these churches in Galatia, up there in the north. And he goes and he tells them, on the first day of the week, I want you all to lay aside money and set it aside for this offering. Because when I come back through, I'll pick it up and we'll take it to the church down at Jerusalem. And so he gave, that's 1 Corinthians 16, 1 and 2. And then he comes over here and he stops where Amy is and Zoe. And this is the church of Ephesus. And he stops here and he writes a letter now to the church at Corinth, across the Aegean Sea and down south. And so he writes a letter up there to Luann and Cherry. He writes a letter to Corinth. And he says, when I get there, I want you to be prepared to give. And so 2 Corinthians 8 and 9 are a letter about that. And so then he crosses over the Aegean Sea and Thessalonica over here. Martin is Thessalonica, and Berea, and Nicholas is Philippi. These churches back here, they gave so much money. They're the ones that he's writing about, the churches in Macedonia, northern Greece. They gave so much money. And so he's telling Luann and Cherry, the Corinthian church, about what a generous offering these churches gave. And so the church at Corinth up here, they're going to get this letter, 2 Corinthians chapters 8 and 9. So they're going to be ready to give generously too when Paul gets there. So that's what these—that's what this is about. And then, of course, Corinth is down there in Achaia. All right? So that's what this whole chapter is about. And the churches back there, Martin and Nicholas, those churches were great affliction. They'd also gone through famine, war-torn mess, deep poverty, and yet they gave to their ability. No, in fact, Paul says they gave beyond their ability. They gave more than they could have or should have. Technically, if you look to see how much they owned, they didn't hardly have anything. And yet they gave, just like the widow who gave her two mites. She gave her livelihood. And so we have in those first four or five verses already some principles of giving, that it's according to their ability. Yes. They also gave sacrificially beyond their ability. And they gave freely willing, it says. That Paul didn't have to command it. They wanted to give. And so when we give to the Lord, it ought to be expressions of our praise and worship, our fellowship, partnership in God's work. We want to have a share and a part in the church at Jerusalem. And by the way, whether it was Corinth or the churches of Macedonia, Philippi, Thessalonica, those churches, or the churches over in Galatia, Iconium, Derbe, Lystra, those churches, it didn't matter the distance or the difference in ethnicity to the Jews. Greeks, Romans, Phrygians, Macedonia, it didn't matter. We want to help these Jews, our brothers and sisters in Christ. And so it showed their love for the brethren and their stewardship and their faith in the Lord. And Paul says they begged us. They begged us to receive the gift. That's amazing. It was almost like Paul was reluctant, saying, no, we can't take that much from you. You don't have that much. You're poor. And Paul says, but they begged us. They petitioned us, exhorted us that we would let them give and share, have a partnership, a koinonia fellowship in that work. The fellowship of the ministering to the saints. We want to be a part of caring for the saints. Now, the word saints is just a word that Paul uses. It means separated ones. It refers to all Christians. It's not some individuals that are more Christian-like than others. No, all people who've been saved by God's grace, who are part of God's family, are called saints. They're separated ones. They're, when God looks down from heaven, there are His saints, His children, born-again people who are trusting Him, and there are those who are not. Okay, there's only those two kinds of people in the world. But this, the fellowship of the saints, to minister to God's people, that's what he's talking about. Paul says, verse 5, not only as we had hoped. He says, and not only as we had hoped. They gave beyond what we could have ever imagined. They first gave themselves to the Lord. First, that is, not first in time, chronologically, but first in priority. They were committed to God. They had surrendered their lives to the Lord. God had saved them by His grace, and they had surrendered to Him. They were in submission to the Lord. And so whatever God wants, I'm gonna live my life out of love and service to Him. And so they'd already committed, devoted themselves to Him. And then it says in verse 5, and to us. They gave themselves to the Lord, and then to us. Us, who's the us? Well, Paul and Silas. They committed themselves to us. I mean, they trusted us. They trusted our message. When I told them about the need for there, they entrusted themselves to us. But I think it goes beyond the us. I think Paul said the us is the people of God. Paul probably representing the church in Jerusalem and the needs of the Christians there. They gave themselves to us, as in the Christians, the church of God in large. Yeah, they were not only devoted to God, but they were devoted to God's people, the saints. That's the us. And then it says, by the will of God. By the will of God, they did that. Yeah, it was God's will. That's an interesting thing, because when we talk about the will of God, it's used a number of times in Scripture. It has two different connotations. There's what we refer to as the revealed will of God, and that's the Bible. This is where God reveals His will to us. God says, do not steal, do not commit adultery, do not covet. That's God's will. That's how we're supposed to live, okay? This God has revealed to us how He wants us to live and behave. I want you to love one another as I have loved you. Okay, God, you've told me what your will is, your desire for how I'm supposed to live. And so this, from Genesis to Revelation, is the revealed will of God. And then there's also the sovereign will, or the secret will of God. And we don't know what that is, but we do know that God has an eternal plan, a master plan, if you will, that he has written in his mind, whatever, but he has this master eternal plan from all eternity past that explains and that details every single thing that will ever happen. All right? And God brings it about. God superimposes, so he oversees, he somehow manages to bring his will to completion every single day in every single person's life, in every country. God has his will, and he governs this world, and he governs all people. He has a sovereign will. We don't understand. We don't know that. All we know is that this is how we're supposed to live. Do we always do it? No, but this is what we're supposed to do. And so you've got the revealed will, and then you have God's sovereign will. And it says here that they gave themselves to the Lord and to us by the will of God. God had determined that somehow, and God brought that about somehow. Well, in fact, if you go back to verse 1, he started with that, didn't he? When Paul says, moreover, brethren, he's writing up to the church at Corinth here, Cherry and Luann, he's writing to them. He says, I want to make known to you the grace of God bestowed on the churches of Macedonia. So the churches over there, Paul says, I want to tell you about the grace of God that was bestowed on them. So this is God working in their life somehow. Mysteriously, the grace of God bestowed on them, which caused them to be generous, joyous, liberal givers to the people in Jerusalem. And so that's what he says here, that they gave. They implored us with much urgency that we'd receive the gift and the fellowship, the ministering to the saints. And they gave more than we hoped for. They gave themselves to the Lord. They gave them to us by the will of God. Yes, the grace of God worked in their heart to cause them to be this kind of a person. God brought this about somehow out of his mysterious sovereign will. And then notice the next phrase. It's in verse 6. So we urged Titus. I find that those two phrases back to back are interesting. The end of verse 5, by the will of God. See that God works all things according to his plan and purpose. God somehow, miraculously, mysteriously, supernaturally, works everything out according to his perfect plan. And that includes our sin and our failure, and how God brings everything out perfectly, I don't know. But we know in Scripture that God's sovereignty and man's responsibility go hand in hand. That we can have a God who has an eternal plan, and yet we can also have free, moral, accountable people that God has revealed his will to and are responsible to carry it out and do it. And so we can never just say, oh, well, God's will be done. I'll just let God do whatever he wants to do, and I'm not going to do anything. No, God holds us accountable to do it. He's revealed. He says, do this, do this, do this. And so I do this. But then when I do it, well, God. Philippians chapter 2 says it's God who works in us both to will and to do of his good pleasure. How does that happen? I don't know. I'm still an accountable agent and will give an account of my life before God, and yet God works so that his will is always accomplished. I don't know. I do know that God uses human means to accomplish his sovereign will. He uses people to bring about the end that he has determined. Sometimes we fail, sometimes we succeed, but always God works it so that his determined end is accomplished. This is beyond us. You know, it says in Isaiah, your thoughts are not my thoughts. God says, you know, to us, he says, my thoughts are not your thoughts. Your ways are not my ways. My ways are high above your ways. We don't understand how this can be. I just know that in the Scriptures, that God's sovereign plans and man's human responsibility are not at odds, but they always go hand to hand. God uses human means. So it's by the will of God. And yet, Paul in the next phrase says, we urged Titus. Why? Because God needs Tituses to do their work. Titus is going to be sent to encourage the church at Corinth. He's going ahead to encourage them and to present the need and to fulfill the work. God needs people to do his...
That's why we pray. God uses our prayers. I don't know how, but God uses our prayers to fulfill His will. God uses the preaching of the Word. He uses our witnessing and our testimony. He uses us. He uses the light. When we live, it says, "Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven." God's going to bring something about, but He uses us, our light shining, to do it. God uses humans to accomplish His sovereign will. And so we pray and we preach and we live according to His revealed will, and God brings all these other things about. So we urge Titus that as he had begun, so he would also complete this grace in you as well. And so God does use human means. He used Paul to write the letter, didn't he? He used Titus to go and collect the offerings. He used churches. He uses the churches in Galatia. He uses the church at Antioch. He uses the church in Macedonia. He uses these churches to accomplish, to take care of His people in Jerusalem. Churches, people. God uses those. So yes, we are accountable and responsible agents, and yet God's will, His sovereign will always be accomplished. Now He says in verse 7, He says, "But as you abound in everything," He's talking to the church at Corinth, Cherry and Luann, this church up here in Corinth, "you abound in everything." Spiritually, you are a wonderful church. You abound in faith, in speech, in knowledge, and in all diligence, in your love for us. Paul says, you're a wonderful, wonderful church there in Corinth. And then what else does he say? "See that you abound in this grace also," that is this gift of giving. "I want you, the church of Corinth, I want you to be as generous and faithful in your giving as the churches of Macedonia and Galatia are." So they had faith, yep, speech, yep, knowledge, yep, diligence, yep, love for Paul and Silas, yep, and Titus, yep. Great church. How about your giving? And we could look at this as an individual. Go down, "Well, I'm pretty good at this. I'm pretty good at that. I'm pretty good at that. Not too good at that. Not too good at that." Just because we excel in some areas doesn't mean God doesn't want us to be well-rounded and excel in all areas spiritually, does He? So how is your gift of giving, He would ask. "See that you abound also in this grace." And then in verse 8, He says, "I speak not by commandment." Again, giving is not about a command. It's not the law. And Paul, it's the grace of God, isn't it? It's all about gifts and grace and love. It comes from the heart. Paul says, "I am not commanding. This isn't under the law. This is all about grace and love. This is something that must come from you internally. If God moves in your heart, if there's grace and love and joy and liberality, that's what it's about." Paul says it's not a commandment. And it's the same in the church today. When we take up our tithes and offerings, nobody should feel compelled to give. It's not a law. It's not a rule in our church. "Oh, you got to give." No. We give because we love God. We just give freely out of a heart that loves the Lord. It's not by commandment. We don't, you know, if we compulsion. If you give out of compulsion or being compelled or told that you have to give, that's nothing more than a taxation. Churches don't tax people. God doesn't tax. Now, in the Old Testament, there was a law. God's law regulated how people lived and what they gave in the Old Testament. And there were some things, for example, their tithes, that were not freely given. Those were mandated, regulated by God. Those were mandatory. They also had oodles of free will offerings and sacrifices that they brought out of their free will. These are expressions of thanksgiving, of love to God, of appreciation for all He's done, and they brought those. But now in the New Testament, there's no commandment, no law. It's all internal. Now God's new covenant, the grace of God and the grace of giving, doesn't negate giving. It just makes it an internal matter. And Paul says it's grace. It's about a blessing. It's about liberality. It's about helping others, not about a law. And woe to those churches that demand of their people that they give so much or that they do this. I've heard of churches where people each year they have to sign a pledge card. I promise to give so much money. And then partway through the year they get a call from one of the deacons and saying, hey, you're running behind here. You need to pick up the pace. You said you're going to give this much. You better give. That's a shame. That should never take place in the church of God. There should be no compulsion. It's not. Paul's clear. I speak not by commandment. We don't give because God needs the money. He doesn't. We don't give because Grace Baptist Church needs the money. We don't. We give because we love God. And that's what he says in this next verse, the next phrase. Paul says, I speak not by commandment, but I am testing the sincerity of your love. Testing the sincerity of your love by the diligence of others. The Corinthians is going to be a test of their love, and he's using the diligence of the Macedonian churches as an incentive. But he says, this matter of giving, your liberality, it's nothing more than a test of your love. Do you really love? Do you love God? Do you love the saints, your brothers and sisters in Christ in Jerusalem? Do you care about them? That they're starving to death? That the ministry's not going on because they don't have any money? What is the amount of love? That's what giving is. How much do you love God? I guess I got to wrap this up here. So to prove the sincerity of your love. In fact, verse 10, he follows the same thing. And in this I give advice. It's not a command. This is Paul's opinion. This is Paul. And by the way, Paul's advice is based on biblical truths that we're supposed to honor the Lord with our substance and we're supposed to love one another and everything. And Paul knows the Proverbs that if you give generously, you're going to reap generously. So he says, I give this as advice. It's to your advantage. Not only to be doing what you began and were desiring to do a year ago, but now you also must complete the doing of it. And notice in verse 11, that there was a readiness. You already had a readiness to desire it. Paul says this isn't by command. This is already something you had a readiness. You had a desire to give. I'm not commanding. This isn't by compulsion or mandatory. This is out of love. It's attesting the sincerity of your love. It's the readiness of your hearts, the desire of your heart. A readiness, a desire. They were already predisposed and willed to do this. It's internal. See, coming from their heart. Verse 12, he says this, for if there is first a willing mind, and that's what they had. They had a willing mind. In fact, that word willing, it's the same Greek word as the word from readiness in the previous verse. They had a ready mind. They were willing. They'd already set their heart that they wanted to do this. Chapter 9 and verse 7, if you look down there, he goes on, he says, so let each one give as he purposes in his heart. That's what Christian giving is. Not mandatory, not law. It's as you purpose in your heart. And that word purpose is the idea of setting priorities. It's that you are determining, this is important to do in my life. I want to do this. And that's what the word purpose means. I've set this as a priority in my life. These people, the Lord, this ministry, these are important. And so I'm putting that here and I've purposed to do this. Romans 15, it pleased them. He's talking about the churches of Galatia at this point. He says it pleased them. It was good to them. Not I pushed them into it, I forced them, I sent them an IOU. No, no. It was good. It arose from the loving kindness of their own hearts. It pleased them. To make a contribution. And by the word, the contribution there again, it's the word koinonia. It's the word fellowship, partnership. They gave something to be a part of the ministry. So I guess that we'll just close here. We'll ask these questions. Do my gifts, when I give to the Lord, do my gifts prove the sincerity of my love? And again, I just want to remind you, don't ever give out of peer pressure. Don't ever give out of compulsion or feeling it's mandatory. Unless, here's a caveat, unless you're a parent and you've got a five-year-old sitting next to you, and you want, maybe you get paid every month, and so you're going to give your offering to the Lord once a month. But if you have a child sitting next to you, I would suggest, parents, that you use the offering envelope, and every week you put something in it, just as an example to your son or your daughter. Sometimes that's good for them to learn. But anyways, no, we just give because it's a reflection of the love of my heart. There's no compulsion outwardly. Do my gifts, do they reflect God's infinite love for me? Do I have an understanding of how much God has loved me, sent his son to be my savior? What he's done in my life? Do they correspond to my love for God? Are my gifts some kind of a token, a manifestation of my love for him? And how about my brothers and sisters in Christ? Do my gifts express my love for them? A great portion of our money goes, for example, overseas to help churches and pastors and ministries in Ghana, in Haiti, in India, Africa. These gifts go there because of there are brothers and sisters in Christ involved in the gospel ministry. That's what we give. Out of a heart of love. No other constraint. The love of Christ constrains me. That's it. Heavenly Father, thank you for your word. And even what seems to be sometimes an embarrassing or touchy subject, we're thankful that your word has spoken on these issues and that we can glean these teachings right out of your word. And that even though we're talking about giving of our money, our wallets, it's not really about money and finances. It's about giving blessings. It's about giving to God. It's about demonstrating our love. It's about sharing in the work of God and having a part in other people's lives that are in need. And so we just pray, Father, that we would see our gifts as you see them, Lord, in a spiritual frame of mind. And we'll be careful to praise you in everything. In Jesus' name, amen. We're going to close by singing one verse. It's hymn number 323, but I have the words up here. We're going to sing just this one verse. It was written by Elizabeth Prentice, and in regard to why she wrote this song, one person asked her, and this is what she said why she wrote it. To love Christ more is the deepest need, the constant cry of my soul, out in the woods and on my bed and out driving and when I'm happy and busy and when I'm sad and idle. The whisper keeps going up for more love, more love, more love. That's pretty good. And that's why she wrote this song, More Love to Thee, O Christ. Let's stand and sing. We'll just sing the first verse. That 25, 50, 100 years from now when I'm in heaven, I'll be asking myself, why didn't I just show Christ more love? It won't be anything about here on earth. I wish I'd done this more or that. It's more love to Christ. Heavenly Father, it is our desire, and we just pray that you would grace us internally, that you would mold and make our hearts more in love with our Savior, more surrender to do your will, more compassion and care for your people. We want to be used of you. We want to be profitable servants. And so we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.